Hello, everybody. It's that time again of the week. It's time for another episode of Mondays with Mundy, and that's me, Jim Mundy, the historian for the Union League Legacy Foundation. And if you watched the last episode, you know that we spent it talking about two specific houses in Newport, Rhode Island that were built for and by League members. And I thought we'd go to part two this week. And I think it's going to be a part three, to be honest. There's still a few more houses I think they're worth talking about. But this episode, we're going to go back into the 19th century, which we did not do the last time. And we'll have one foot in the door of the early 20th century. So we'll do two more houses today. Even though one of the houses was built for and by a League member, but the other one was built by a League member, though not for a League member. So let's solve the mystery and get started, all right? Which means I've got to share my screen. Oh my gosh, it looks like... Can't believe it. Come on. There we go. Holy cow. It must have taken me a half hour to get that last time. I don't know why I did it today. So League members in Newport, part two. Here we are, we're back to this map again because it's the obvious one to use. So the first house we're talking about is called Fairholme, F-A-I-R-H-O-L-M-E, and it was built by Fairman Rogers. And if you look at this map, along the right-hand side, you'll see the airport insignia, the air plane, right? Just go straight down the coastline and you see number one, all right? That's basically where we're going. Number one represents the breakers, but Fairholme was built right across the street. And that'll give you some idea what that is. And the next house we're going to do is the Elms. So if you go back up to the airport and see and go to the left, you'll see house number three. That's the second house, the Elms. So that's the neighborhood we're going to be in. We're going to be in today. Okay. And here we go. And this is Fairholme, as it was designed for Fairman Rogers by his brother-in-law, Frank Furness. Now, both were members of the League. Fairman Rogers joined the League in January of 1863 and is considered a founding member. Frank Furness, who was a Civil War veteran, as was Rogers, but Furness didn't join the League until the summer of 1865 when he came back from the war, the Civil War itself. This style is called the stick style, very popular in the 19th century, the last quarter of the 19th century, to be succeeded basically maybe by the shingle style, if you will. So that's Fairholme as it was built for Fairman Rogers by Frank Furness. And there's Fairman Rogers himself, this very distinguished looking man. We've come across him before in a couple different ways, specifically about Thomas Aikens and his painting The Four in Hand. So let me go back to Rogers, still a bit about him. He graduated from the University of Pennsylvania in 1853 with a degree in civil engineering, which he taught between 1855 and 1871. And in 1871, he was also the head of the building committee at the Pennsylvania Academy of the Fine Arts. And it's no surprise then, is it, that it was his brother-in-law, Frank Furness, who got the winning bid to build the new Paffett building on North Broad Street. That is spectacular. Furness's crowning achievement. So it's a lot of the world is who we know and stuff like that. So but anyway, so Fairman Rogers would eventually go on to Actually, didn't actually enjoy his house, believe it or not. They really did. He and his wife, who it turns out was whose sister, Kate, was married to Frank Furness's brother, Horace, the Shakespearean scholar. You can see how these family dots connect. Whatever. So here we have a map of Newport that's a little more zoomed in, and there's Fairholme. So above the yellow line, which is actually, that is called Ruggles Avenue, R-U-G-G-L-E-S. And the line coming down from the top intersecting it was known as Ochre Point Road. So the space immediately to the right, without a name, is where the Breakers is located. And you may remember that this whole thing got started because I went to the Victorian Society's Newport Summer School, and our dorm was Ochre Lodge, which is just across the street from both the Breakers and Fairholme. And how lucky can one get? So this gives you some idea of what the geography of Newport, what we're talking about. So this is the entrance hall to Fairholme. And again, remember, this is a late 19th century building, or 1875 is when it was built for Fairman Rogers. And this is the dining room. Another tapestries were everywhere. So keep in mind, though, that 20 years later, 1897, Edith Wharton with Ogden Codman Jr. would write the book, The Decoration of Houses, and they would call for a simplification of interiors, and that's what we will get. So what happens? So this is the house. All right. Now, what happened is that the Rogers moved to Paris in 1890, so they sold the house to John Rosé Drexel, who was the son of A.J. Drexel, who was a founding member of the League, although John didn't join the League because he lived mostly in New York. But he and his wife were renting it from the Rogers in the beginning, and then they eventually bought it. And it was in 1909 that they hired Horace Trumbauer, the ubiquitous Horace Trumbauer, to help expand the building. And so what we have is on the right-hand side, that second story with the dormers was the Trumbauer addition, because that's the service wing. And on the far left-hand side, that single-story part, is a ballroom that was added by Trumbauer as well. And the basic building is still there, but we'll see what happens later on. And this is what it looks like today, because what happened is that the Drexels lived there until 1930 when they moved to Paris, which is what the Rogers had done, and they sold it to Count Alfonso Villa and his wife, who happened to be a Philadelphian, Helen Lippincott. And in 1942, the Lippincotts hired a New York architect, Dwight James Baum, to what I would call tutorize the house. And so this is what we just saw as to what happened to it in 1942 with its tutorization. So that's the front of it, if you will. This is what it looks like from the air. And what you can see in the upper right-hand corner, that's actually the breakers, believe it or not. Okay. And again, is the service wing on the right-hand side and the ballroom on the left. This is what it looks like from the water side. So that's the cliff walk in front of it. Beautiful big lawn. It's about 500 feet of frontage, I believe. All right. This is the floor plan as of 1930. So this is really basically the Trumbauer floor plan, if you will. All right. So again, because Bond didn't do any work until 1942. So you can see at the top, see what became, that space on the right-hand side became the ballroom and the service wing is on the left-hand side. All right. And just to show you some interior shots, the house has passed through a couple of owners, but it's still in private ownership. And again, that always seems to be the trouble with Newport homes owned by Philadelphians. They tend to stay private. So it's really hard to get good inside views, and it's hard to visit them as well. But you can see how this room was Tudorized from what we saw on the Furness edition of it. And this is another variation on it. It's a more modern variation, what one of our recent owners has done, but it still has that Tudoresque look to it. Very much so, especially in that ceiling hole, that strapwork, Elizabethan strapwork. This is the ballroom that was added by Trumbauer. All right, you can see it's a fairly low barrel vault, but it seats about 120 people. So good job there. This is the salon, if you will, we would call the living room today. Very French in style with different elements of the Louis Couture's furniture in it. Beautiful fireplace and mantle. And then for more information about these pre 1890, and they truly were cottages in a way. Michael Catherine's, who I mentioned last time, also has a book that just came out this summer on Newport Cottages 1835 to 1890, worth the read. So, all right, so our next house is going to be the Elms, which is just one of the most magnificent houses in Newport, if nothing else, because it's so much smaller in scale than places like the Breakers or even the Marble House. You can actually wrap your head around it and your eyes, to be honest. So this is another example of Trumbauer's copying a pre-existing house, this one outside of Paris called Les Châteaux Asnières. But it's not an exact duplicate the way that Clarendon Court was. A copy of the Hedworth House in County Durham in England. There are a number of variations between this and the actual model itself outside of Paris, but still you get the idea. Another splendid French Neoclassical Revival house. And this is the entrance facade. And this is the Berwind family, because it was built for Julius and Sarah Berwind. And that is he front, second from the right, and his wife to the further right. And then to the left, the woman, the lady with the black hair, is actually their daughter, Julia, who married the gentleman standing by her, was named Robert Strawbridge, who was the son of Justice Strawbridge, one of the founders of Strawbridge and Clothiers. So as you can see, the family didn't have any problems with money, right? So Edward Julius Berwind was born in Philadelphia in 1844. He would die in Newport in 1944, right? That's, that is he and his family. And this is the garden facade. So this is the rear of the building, if you will. All right. Now, if you haven't noticed, the building, see if we can go back and take a look at there. It's a little hard to tell, but the building actually sits on an elevated basement, which gives it some substantial height, meaning you have to walk up to it. So it's not just sitting on the ground. It actually elevates it above, which gives it a much better visual image and look than if we're just parallel, just sitting on the ground itself. And this is a photograph that I took when I was there back in early June to give you some idea of just how that lawn is just expansive. Monstrous. So here we have more professional photographs on the left-hand side of the backside, which would be the garden side. And it was considered to have one of the best gardens in all of Newport, but unfortunately, it's called the Elms for a reason. But all the elm trees are gone because of the Dutch elm disease. So now the magnificent trees are weeping beeches, and they're magnificent themselves. And you can see the floor plan on the right-hand side. So you walk in, you go through the front entrance into the stair hall, and this is what you see. And it is absolutely breathtaking. That is cayenne marble limestone. It is spectacular. I mean, it's mind-boggling. And again, like everything else that Trumbauer does, this is a better proportioned house than many of the ones in Newport. And this is actually a better proportion than the original one outside of Paris. This is the dining room, which is one of the few rooms in the house that is not done in the French neoclassical style. This is Italian all the way. Good boy. Now, the Elms is open to the public, and it's one of the most heavily visited houses in Newport. So get yourselves up there and see it, because it's just spectacular. Here we have the ballroom with its 19th century Steinway grand piano that is done in gilt. What the heck, if you can afford it, why not? And by the way, that chandelier hanging down at the top is from Baccarat. Not your everyday provider of crystal, is it? But what the heck, if you got it, you spend it. And this is the family's sitting room or drawing room on the second floor. And this was their main social room. This is where they would gather every evening to talk before dinner and to talk after dinner and things like that. And it is not as ostentatious as the rooms on the first floor, but it's still pretty spiff, if you will. All right. Here is the Berwind ciphers. Here is an EJB. I don't really talk much about Berwind. Let's see, he graduated from the U.S. Naval Academy in 1869 and would stay in the Navy until 1875 with a stint at the White House as a naval attaché to the Grant presidency. In 1875, he would retire from the Navy and join his older brother, Charles, who had just shortly before formed the Berwind White Coal Mining Company, which would eventually become the largest one of its kind in the country. Charles became managing partner until he died in 1890, at which point the younger brother, Edward, took over. And it was at that point that Edward was considered to own more coal land than any individual in the United States. So he had quite a lot of it. All right. So, this is in the era when the American Navy used coal for its warships. And of course, the railroads were using steam engines that use coal for their steam engines. And so Berwind, because of its location and of course, its centrality to the coal mines, was able to supply the majority of coal to both the Navy and these Northeastern railroads. Why not? So this is the view looking to the rear. And it's a shame is that you can see the beaches there in the background, but no elms are left. But you can see on the left-hand side, it was a tea room because that's where the sunken garden was located, done in a Venetian style, if I recall. But again, there's not a flower growing there. At least there wasn't when I was there in June. So I really didn't think it was worth looking at, but it's hopefully they'll bring it back someday. So what happened is that, so Sarah Berwin died in 1922, and Edward asked their daughter Sarah to become his lady of the house, if you will. And she then became that until she died in 1961. And she, the house, by the way, was one of the first houses in Newport to actually have electricity. But that's about as modern as it got, because once she took over, she wanted everything to stay the way it was. She adhered to the 6-week summer schedule, basically mid-July to the end of August. She never added washing machines or drying machines and things like that. She kept the house staff at 40, even though they didn't need 40, but that's the way it was. And that's what she did. And then eventually, after she died, it was left to nieces and nephews, but none of them really wanted it. So one nephew in 1962 put the whole place up for auction, but after he sold all the contents. And at this point, the Preservation Society of Newport County stepped in and purchased the house for $116,000. It was built for, I think, $1.5 million. So it is, again, as I said earlier, one of the most visited houses on the in Newport, and I would encourage every one of you to go up and see it. So the Berwinds, however, don't live in Newport anymore. They live in Ballykinwood, just to the western suburbs outside of Philadelphia. And this is the Berwind Mausoleum at West Laurel Hill Cemetery in Ballykinwood. And I'll give you three guesses who designed it, and the first two don't count. Okay. Indeed, it's Horace Trumbauer. So patterned after the Temple of the Winds in Athens. So that's the end of this week's episode. I hope you enjoyed it. For all these houses, we could be talking for hours more. But I hope that you get the chance to go to Newport sometime and take a look at them. It's really worth it. So we'll see what happens in the next 2 weeks and what we look at then. But in the meantime, thank you very much for watching. We truly appreciate your patronage. Hope you're enjoying these. And just stay well, stay healthy, and we'll see you in 2 weeks. Thank you very much.